Well, welcome, ladies and gentlemen and children. Thank you so much for coming. It's a real joy to see you here. This is a special evening for us because we have Jonathan and Erin from Caring for Life up in Leeds to talk to us about their work, and we're very much looking forward to that. So thank you so much for travelling all the way down, and we're going to look forward to hearing from you. Some of you might know quite a bit about Caring for Life. Some of you might know next to nothing about Caring for Life, but I'm sure by listening to Jonathan and Erin, all of us by the end of the evening will certainly know a lot more. So we look forward to that. It's great to have friends from Naunton Lane here. Thank you so much for coming. It's a joy always to share fellowship with you and to do these things together. So a special welcome to you. We're going to begin by singing 843, and then I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to hand over to Jonathan and Erin, and there'll be some time for questions afterwards, brief time of prayer, and then you can explore the tables afterwards. So 843, He giveth more grace when the burdens grow greater.
Thank you.
Let's pray together. Our gracious Father in heaven, we come to you and we come to adore you in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Holy Spirit. We come to adore you for who you are, the triune God, who is eternal and infinite and unchanging. And we come to adore you for what you have done. Father in heaven, you so loved the world that you gave your only begotten Son, that whoever believes on him should not perish, but have eternal life. You have given us your best. You have given us your Son, the Lord Jesus. And in your Son are all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. All the grace that we need is in the Lord Jesus Christ. He is your grace. He is your glory. And we thank you for the work of Caring for Life, which expresses this truth about the overflowing love of the Father in the Son and by the Spirit. And we pray, O Lord, that you would bless us this evening. We pray that you would inform our minds, Lord, that you would shape our wills and that you'd move our affections to love you more and to love the lost and to love the needy. Lord, help us not to be those that are in our comfortable homes and only caring for ourselves. Help us not to be self-absorbed, but to have a heart like our Lord Jesus, who had compassion on the crowds and saw them as sheep without a shepherd. So, Lord, we pray that you would be with Jonathan and Erin as they speak to us. And we pray, O Lord, that your Holy Spirit would be at work to your glory. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. I hand over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, David.
Well, thank you so much for the opportunity to come and share with you tonight. My name is Jonathan Parkinson. I'm the CEO of Caring for Life, but I have been pretty much involved from almost day one, and certainly lived amongst and grown up amongst the whole issue around Caring for Life, which you'll learn a little bit more about in the beginning. So I've been involved in this ministry for an awful long time. Don't like to think how long. I've got like a life sentence. I'm not allowed to leave. And Erin is one of my senior managers. She manages our benefits team. And tonight, between us both, I hope and pray that you will be enlightened, challenged. You will be. We all have to be challenged by what we see in the world, the brokenness of this world. But I hope you also be encouraged by what God is doing. There is power in the gospel, and God is at work. And often when you look at the world, you think, oh my goodness, we're on the losing side. But we're not. We're on the victory side. And we have a mighty God. A mighty God who is always watching, he's always keeping us, but he's always reaching out to the lost. And that's what we seek to do, reach out to the lost through the work of ministry of Caring for Life. Some of you know the ministry very well. You've been friends and partners of ours for an awful long time. And I want to thank you for your love and your affection for Caring for Life, this ministry. And of course, that flows out of your love for Christ and your passionate desire, as ours is, to see the lost won. So thank you so very much for all that you do and all your prayers and all of your gifts. Just a brief overview of what Caring for Life is and how we got to be here today. Well, Caring for Life is an explicitly Christian ministry that grew out of my father's church. My father was a Baptist minister back in Leeds. He moved to Leeds in 1968 and had always had a real heart for the marginalised. He formed a church called Leeds Reformed Baptist Church in 1972. And one of the early members of that church was as a young girl who was a student in Leeds called Esther Smith, who eventually went to work for Leeds Social Services managing some of the children's homes. Prior to that, my dad had started running some camps in North Wales, and he always allocated a quarter of those places and funded a quarter of those places for kids from dysfunctional homes or children from care. So we were already in contact with people from messy backgrounds. But Esther, by the grace of God, and this is a wonderful thing, was able to bring her children from the home to our Sunday schools if they wanted to come. They came to our boys' brigades and our girls' brigades. They came on our camps. And some of those kids came to faith. And these were the very kids I grew up with. That's what I mean. I've grown up around this issue right from day one. But they were very messed up kids, very damaged children. But it was wonderful the way that we saw the Lord work in their lives. I'll never forget, sorry, I digress. You've got to tell me to shut up if I carry on. But I never will forget the faces of some of our Sunday school teachers when some of our kids turned up. It's like, turned ashen. Oh no, Andrew's back. Like, they bred terror into people. But we loved them. They were family to us. But when those kids left care, they were left to look after themselves. And back in the day, there was no follow-up support. There was nobody looking out for these kinds of guys as they left care. So in our church, our fairly middle-class Reformed Baptist church, we had an ever-growing number of individuals. One or two of them were getting in trouble with the police. One or two of the girls had been groomed and were being used in the sex trade. Others who were just not looking after themselves and were looking more and more thin. Just a total mess right before us. And then out of the blue one night, just a bunch of homeless guys turned up and just hung around. And it was one Sunday, my father, before the morning service, said to Esther, he said, "Esther, somebody ought to do something about this. There's Andrew. Look at the state Andrew's in." And he was like a brother to me. He was part of our family, was always around our house. "There's Shane, there's Paula, there's Mandy. Look at these guys. Somebody ought to do something about this." And she prodded him in the chest and said, "Well, what are you going to do about it, Pastor?" And he said, "Well, what can I do? I'm just a Baptist minister." And she said, "Well, you can do something or you can do nothing. The choice is yours," and storms off. So it left him in a bit of a tiz. But, you know, he would say that that day, Esther was really the Lord's voice speaking to him. "What are you going to do, Peter Parkinson, for your own flesh and blood? What are you going to do for these very people who are part of your family? They're in your church. What are you going to do to not just minister, but care for these people as your own children? What are you going to do?" And in many respects, the scene was speaking to him. The scriptures were speaking to him, because that morning, his morning reading was Isaiah 58 on true fasting. And he said it was almost as if everything and everyone, but ultimately the Lord, was whacking him, saying, "What are you going to do?" So Caring for Life was brought into being. We're going to do something. So a guy was leaving our home, our church, to move south with work. And he said, "You can have our house," because a group of people got together and they've been praying about this. And said, "Well, let's meet this immediate need of homelessness that some of these guys are facing. And let's try and get some stability to these people's lives. And then let's try and help them rebuild their lives practically, you know, and help them move forward." And he spoke to one of our guys who was part of the church and said to him, "If we were able to find a safe place for you to move into, would you like to move in there?" He said, "Oh yes, I'd love to move into somewhere safe, Uncle Peter." This guy was being groomed by a local bank manager, awful situation. And he said, "Okay, you've got to keep strong, because we're going to see what we can do." Well, in that 1 week, before the mobile phone, remember, it's 1986, 87 individuals contacted my dad and said, literally, "We're here, you've got a place for us to live, because we ain't got nowhere. Can we come and move in?" Because he kept his gob shut. It's amazing. I remember late at night, we lived up a rumpy old farm track on an old rickety old farm. It was a right tip, but it was a right job to get to us. There was a knock on the door, 10:30 at night, and we opened the kitchen door, and there was three really rough looking lads there. And it was me and my dad in the kitchen, and we thought, this is going to kick off. What's going on here? And one of the guys just said, he said, "We're looking for Pastor Parkinson." And my dad said, "Well, that's me." He said, well, we ain't got nowhere to live, but we hear you've got somewhere we can live. And this was in that first week. It was amazing how the Lord just brought to us, not just those people in our church, but loads of people. And it was the Lord saying, are you ready? Because it's a big issue. And we thank the Lord that those people, our predecessors, as it were, had the faith to step out for the Lord to try and meet the needs in our city. One of the big issues that we've always faced is homelessness. But homelessness is just the tip of the iceberg. There are all sorts of reasons why people live such chaotic lives. And you will agree with me that the world we live in is an incredibly chaotic world. Well, so many people we share the love of Christ with and the gospel with are people who live incredibly chaotic lives. And our reason for being is not just to stick a plaster on the issue of a homelessness, find somebody a home, or just help somebody find mental health support or sort out their benefits. It's to find out why people are so damaged, why they live such chaotic lives, and to take into that world the message of Christ, the one that can bring true healing, true hope into that place. We know, don't we, when you become a Christian, not all your problems disappear. They don't. But we know that we have a peace and we have a Saviour. We have a God who is with us in the chaos. So that's really caring for life in a nutshell. We take his love into these very chaotic places. But many people say, well, why do you do what you do? And you have to go to God's word to learn about why we do what we do, because we learned it throughout the whole of Scripture, from the Lord to his children. If you love me, I command you to express your love in certain ways. And I suppose one of the passages I'll bring before you this evening, you'll find it in James chapter 1. And in James chapter 1, we're told what true religion looks like. And we're told in verse 27 that religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. And then he goes on in chapter 2 and he says, verse 14, what good is it, my brothers, if a man claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save him? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to him, go, I wish you well, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about his physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it's not accompanied by actions, is dead. We know that James isn't saying, do these things and you earn your way to heaven. He's not saying that. He's saying, if you've been saved by grace, if Christ means anything to you, if your faith means anything to you, that wonderful gift that we've been given, then you're going to go and share that gift. And it's often going to flow from you in practical ways because you're going to see people in need around you. And that's a great challenge to us. That is true religion. Because Jesus' words in Matthew 25, which mean a huge amount to us. And he says, your responsibility as one of my children is to go and feed the hungry and clothe the naked and so forth. It's a call to action. But I suppose John's words in 1 John 4, this is really a reality check to us all, because we're reminded there, aren't we, by John, that we love purely because he first loved us. That's our response to the needs that we see around us. We love because he has poured out his love upon us. That's a reality check. And the passage that you mentioned, or alluded to in your prayer, Matthew 9, think about Jesus up on the mountainside with all those people he's been ministering to for 2 or 3 days. They've been hanging off him, feeding off him. And then at the end of that time, many of them were disappearing off, weak and wobbly at the knees. Do you remember? Because they'd been feeding off him. And he calls his disciples because he had compassion on them. He said, feed these guys. They've had their souls fed. Now feed their bodies, because his compassion saw them disappearing off. Now we care for people. We share his love with people who are weak and wobbly at the knees. They have no strength. They have no resolve. And often we have to be the ones who have to be strong for them, to walk with them, not to do everything for them, but to walk with them, to enable them to find dignity and hope and strength, because they don't find it in themselves. So what we do really at Caring for Life is a practical outworking of what God says we should do through his word. You know, the Proverb 31:8, he calls us to speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves. For the rights of all who are destitute, speak up and judge fairly, defend the rights of the poor and the needy. That's what we do. And who do we do it for? Ultimately, we do it for God. We do it because we love him. We do it because he loves us. We do it for his glory. But we also do it for the rejects and the, the ones who are looked down upon in society, those who are the social misfits, the outcasts, the very people actually Jesus hung out with. They're the ones we do it for. They're the ones that he has laid on our hearts. Spurgeon talked about that the poor should weigh heavy on a Christian's heart. Well, they weigh heavy on our hearts. And that's why we're passionate about reaching out and meeting them, engaging with them, taking Christ to them. My friend has written a book called The Least, the Last and the Lost. It's a very challenging book. And in many respects, they're the people we share Jesus' love with, the least, the last and the lost. We thank the Lord that now there are many who are not lost anymore. They found a saviour. They now own Jesus as Lord. So now they just feel like they're still the least, the last, but they're not the lost. Praise God. Hey? And we want to see many more step into what we call the wonderful world of Jesus. And to do that, we need him to be at the helm of everything that we do. Aaron's going to share with you a few live issues that go on. And then I'd like to talk, if it was okay, about a few minutes about root causes of why people live such chaotic lives. Okay?
Hello, everyone. It is so lovely to be with you. So thank you for having us. Thank you for letting us to come and share what the Lord's doing at Caring for Life. As Jonathan said, the community of people that we work with and we try to share the love of Jesus with is a chaotic one. They make bad decisions. Bad things are forced upon them and thrust upon them. And chaos really is the norm for many of those in our care. But God brings calm into the chaos, doesn't he? He brings light into the darkness. And so we practically seek to meet people's needs, and through that and through our words and our actions, to point people to Jesus, to our precious Saviour. But the moment at Caring for Life, we have a number of pastoral issues going on. I could talk for the next about 7 hours, but I will narrow it down to three, and then you can throw things if I don't. But the three major big ones, I suppose, going on, number one is the poverty. I suppose it's not unknown that's been a big issue for years and years and years and years and years, and will continue to be a big issue on and on. But the cost of living crisis has really made that situation a lot worse. For many of those in our care, it's made the situations they're facing much more difficult. They've struggled to meet payment arrangements, they're further in debt, and it's caused massive issues for them. The cost of living crisis, the government has tried to add in some measures to try and help people, but in reality, that's not really touching the sides. And we have a number of our care who are struggling to make ends meet, who are ending up in dangerous situations as a result of the debt that they are in. I'll give you but one example. One gentleman who I support, when he came to us, he was surviving on £334 a month, and that was to pay for everything. Food, electric, heating, rent, everything, £334. And this gentleman has worked all his life. He has had many jobs. His favourite one was a delivery driver, and he could tell you every street in Leeds if you asked him. Don't ask that question, it gets dangerous. But he had worked all his life and was in a car accident, and the car ran him down, and he ended up with damage to his body. But following that then, his bones started to break anytime he moved. And so because of that, he was struggling to do anything, and he couldn't work, and he couldn't seek work. And so we had the privilege of walking alongside him during that season and to be able to apply for benefits with him. But one of the things we were able to do was to give him food parcels, and we're so thankful for our supporters that helped him through that season. And he talked about how whenever we got all that sorted and through that whole season, how he always felt like he finally could breathe. He felt relief because everything was so much pressure. He didn't know how he was going to make ends meet and how he was going to support his family and his children and his grandchildren. So that's one massive issue. The second one is the decline of the mental health and the physical health of many of those in our care. I think this is a bit of a legacy from COVID. You know, many of those issues were live before we even had the pandemic, but the pandemic really exonerated those issues and brought them to the forefront yet again. And for many in our care, they've regressed in the progress that they made previously. One lady who we support suffers terribly with agoraphobia, so much so that she can't even leave her front door. And she talks about how leaving the house, but staying in the house also feels like a prison. She feels like she's completely trapped where she's at. And before the pandemic, we had managed carefully, and a long time it took. She'd finally come up to projects and was starting to engage with our therapeutic projects up at the farm, and was coming to art once a week, and she was coming up to do work in the farm shop as well and do a little bit of that. Since the pandemic, she hasn't been able to leave her front door. She can't even go into the garden without having panic attacks. And that's just the complete chaos that COVID has brought about in her life. But for many in our carers, they're struggling to engage with mental health support, they're struggling to engage with doctor's appointments, and they're struggling to get the help that they really need. And this all then leads into the physical health and how that's impacted if things aren't being checked and being looked at. And they struggle to care for themselves as well. The third major issue is housing. I suppose that's been a long-term issue for us. It's nothing new under the sun. But the need for safe and appropriate housing for those in our care. Many of the folks that we have in our care live in really unsafe, dire circumstances. Houses that, if you walked in, would shock you and break my heart every time we do. Properties that are not meeting needs, they're unsafe. People feeling intimidated in their own homes. People being victim from their neighbours, coming in and taking money off them or selling them things that they're actually not selling the right things. So it's quite dark, it's quite dangerous, and it's hard to get safe accommodation. I looked at some statistics and we're really struggling to find safe homes. The local authority is struggling to find safe homes for people. And I think that's an issue across the country. It's not just in Leeds. But the statistics from December 2022 stated that there was 23,000 people in Leeds looking for social housing. And of those 23,000, 930 were bidding for the same single property. So for every property that we're trying to find for someone, 930 people are in the same situation, just to give you a little bit of a picture of what the situation is like. But you know, God is incredible. And even in the last week, we've had three prayers answered for three people that we were really concerned about. But I want to tell you about one lady. We started supporting her during the pandemic, and she was living in a really unsafe situation. She was being abused within her own home, and it was one of those situations where you were dropping her off, and you didn't quite know if we're going to make contact again. And we were really concerned for her. We were really praying. We had all the help we could to try and get her safely accommodated. She's just moved in to our supported accommodation and is happy and settled. And the ladies are on holiday this week, and this is her first holiday. When I was chatting to her a couple of weeks ago just to say, you know, how are you getting on? How are you finding it? She goes, Erin, I can't believe I can make my own decisions. I can't believe I can do what I want when I need to do what I want. And her life has completely changed and been completely transformed. But there are many, many, many more people in our care who are in need of safe and appropriate housing. I'm going to stop there because otherwise you're going to kill me. But they're the three main big issues that are going on the ground. Do you want to talk about causes?
Thanks, Erin. Yeah, they're huge issues. But I'm just thinking that for those of you who probably weren't aware, there's three main areas to the ministry. One is our housing support team. They've titled all sorts of things. Being their team is what guys in our care wanted it to be called. So they're out in the community just engaging with people in whatever need they find. Try and get people motivated in all sorts of ways, but support them out in the community. And they're supporting at least 150 to 180 people a week out in the community. Then we have two supported living homes. You alluded to one of our young ladies that's just moved into our ladies' home, which are long-term homes, supported homes. They're not hostels at all. There's a real family feel to those homes. And then we have one house for a vulnerable family that we've had for about 4 years now, which we'd love to get more of those in the future. So that's sort of like is how we work, those three sort of like wings to the work. But yes, it is a very chaotic scene, all sorts of things. And as I said, some of these things are just tips of the iceberg, some of the things we address on a daily basis. But it's getting to the root causes of why people live such chaotic lives is so important for us. And some of those root causes to why people live such chaotic lives are not particularly nice ones. Childhood traumas are often a huge part of why people live such chaotic lives, why they're so difficult to engage with, why they have no hope, no purpose in life. They don't feel they're worth anything because of the things that happened in the past. We were just talking on the way down and we were saying it must be between 85 and 90% of the people we support will have suffered abuse as youngsters. That's a huge proportion of the people that have come to us. We really are picking up those who fall through the net. Those who are extremely damaged. And if you've suffered those types of things as a child, that leaves lifelong scars, things that just don't go away. I remember my father, who founded the ministry, he was such a lovely, wise, pastoral man. And he said, you know, part of our role really is to almost be the hands of Jesus covering up those scars, to try and stop those scars being exposed to the elements again. But sometimes your hands get pushed away and the pain is there again. And you know, those kinds of scars from those childhood days, they're the things often that affect people today. You know, I remember a young lady who came to live in Our Lady's home a few years ago now. She was 40 when she came to us. But from the age of 3, right up until 18, when she then left home and was thrown out into a flat, but then was still brought back to the home various times through the week, every day from the age of 3, she was used as a sexual object by her mum and her dad and her uncle and her neighbours from the age of 3. She came to us age 40, and really that was the first day when nothing was expected of her in the most awful ways. I mean, that girl was so messed up. And it was incredible how she began to respond to us, but it did take a long time. But sometimes she would disappear off back to her mum's for the weekend. We often said, please don't go, but she would. And she would come back with hundreds of pounds in her hand because of things that had happened. And it took many years for her to come to realise that's not why God created you. You weren't created for that purpose. You know, if we talk about love to somebody, we might as well be talking double dutch. It doesn't mean anything to them. That's where showing what Christian love looks like is so important, teaching people what a father should be like, and then ultimately what God our Father is like. But that takes an awful long time, hence we're caring for life. We don't set no time limits. We just get working for the Lord in this community of people that he's called us to be part of. And as long as it takes, we'll just keep plugging away with the same message, with the same gospel, praying that the Lord will work in that situation. Well, this young lady ultimately did come to know and love the Lord, but it took her many years to come to realize that she was made in God's image to glorify him, to enjoy him, but to not be treated in that kind of way. And we had to teach her what love was. And love isn't a thing that demands. Love is a thing to give. And often with her, it was like, I want this. I want this off you. And it is awful. So those kinds of things had a huge effect on her. But it's not just her. Another lovely gentleman, he's been with us for many, many years, 30-odd years. And he came to us from a place of crime. But he had a huge criminal record. Police brought him to us. He was a deeply damaged man. But he grew up at home with mum and dad and 2 sisters. One of his sisters committed suicide just a couple of years ago. But his mum would plead, because his father was a very violent and abusive man, please don't hurt the girls. So he got it all. And he just began to withdraw into himself. School realised there was a problem, put him in care. And then when he went into the children's home, the man who ran the home also started to abuse him. So this little boy just ran away from the home. And he was a naughty boy, wasn't he? So they'd take him back to the house. But when he turned 18, he wasn't going to live in a flat. They placed him in a flat. He'd rather live on the streets because he's safer out there. And just to live, he nicked stuff. So yes, he had a criminal record as long as your arm. And he was touted as a dangerous man when he was brought to us. But he wasn't dangerous. He was just an incredibly damaged man. And that's what we saw when we saw him. And we often pray, give us wisdom, Lord. Give us discernment, Lord, as we see people. Because too often we judge folks by how they present themselves, don't we? And we forget there's a whole story that's gone on. And that's how we have to try and address people. Well, that man came to know and love the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'll tell you his testimony another time, wonderfully, gloriously. But in his testimony, he said, I don't know why the things happened to me that they did, but I know there's a God that loves me. He's in my church. He's a member of my church. He still struggles with all sorts of stuff. And to keep him on the straight and narrow, as it were, is really difficult. And that's all stems from issues from the past. And we shouldn't ever take those kind of things for granted when we look at the world that we live in, certainly in our community of people. Childhood traumas have a huge impact on where people are and how they cope in this world today. Also, people not being believed when they talk about things that happened in the past. That's a huge issue. We hear that often. Erin was just sharing with a lady who she's supporting now, who's just blown away the fact that we listen and we believe her when she tells us things. I tell you, this is a true story, this. One of those little girls that grew up in Esther's children's home, okay, that I know so well, grew up together. She was told to go back to her mum and her stepdad every weekend from the children's home. And she would come back and tell Esther the things that were going on. And they weren't nice things. Let's leave it there. And Esther reported that to the social services and said, you mustn't send this child back anymore. They didn't believe what this little girl was saying. And they said, no, we've got to keep families together. When she leaves here, she needs to get back to that family. And this went on for years. Nobody believed her apart from Esther. And Esther kept logging it, kept reporting it. 2 years ago, a police officer contacted me. Esther's retired now. And she says, I'm looking for Esther Smith because I've been looking through some files of historic disclosures. And she said, we believe we've got a case here. So spoke to Esther. They're taking that on. We're praying this guy's going to get convicted. He has been charged with multiple rapes and all sorts of things. And we're praying that there is justice. But do you know what? This will only happen because she was believed many, many years ago, but actually only believed by one person. We shouldn't forget, though, the Lord sees all of this. He knows all of this. And he's just. And he will bring justice to the world. You know, we sing a lovely song at Caring for Life. It's a 20 Schemes song. We long for that day when Jesus comes again, when justice is done and evil cast away. Lovely words. But the final part of that song, it says, oh, may we all be found in Christ that day. You know, if we're not, whether you're abuser or abused, if you're not found in Christ that day, the next day is not a good one, is it? It's not a good one. But the fact that people aren't believed does have a huge impact on why they live such chaotic lives. Issues around just not being cared for or valued, hugely important. Often when people come to us, it's the first time they've actually experienced real love and care. Issues around not being enthused over or encouraged in anything. You know, when I was a little lad, I know I'd bring my paintings home from school. Mum and Dad would put them on the kitchen fridge and say how lovely it was. It was rubbish. I'm being honest, I'm no artist, but they were enthused, and that's right. We enthuse over our children, we encourage one another, and we should do that. But so many in our care, they have never had anybody enthuse over them or encourage them. And that's why one of the wonderful things about Caring for Life is when people come into our environment, we encourage people, we look for the positives. We try and find those little glimmers of interest and try and build upon those types of things. One of the great things we've done in the last few years with the projects that we have on the farm is utilising in a broader kind of way to expand people's horizons. So let's, for example, on our agricultural project, we show our sheep at agricultural shows. And that's been a wonderful experience for people to go to agricultural shows with their sheep. Most of them they've actually brought into the world, looked after, fed, cared for, groomed, cleaned, taken off to shows, and they're pulling awards, national awards. It's wonderful. We just started doing that with the horses. And this is giving people who are deeply damaged, have no purpose in life, no direction, something to get a hold of and say, right, we're going to go and experience something new. It's great. Just reminded me, just one of our guys, because this is, I'll say, part of our work, which you'll have read about in the bulletin, is very much this, replacing bad memories with happy memories. And that's what we seek to do through so many of areas of our work and ministry. But one of our guys who I hadn't seen for a little while, he's one of the early men that we looked after. He was at a bonfire event that we had at my church just this last week. And he said, do you remember that experience when we went water skiing? I said, yes. He said, do you tell people about that? I said, yes, sometimes I do. So I'm going to tell you about that experience with water skiing, right? Replacing a bad memory with a happy one. Because we had use of a ski boat many years ago. And we used to go to Windermere water skiing. Anybody here water skied? Yeah, somebody's nodding, one or two. Well, it's quite hard, but it's great fun when you get a hang of it, okay? So we're on Windermere, and we couldn't afford wetsuits or anything like that, but we had life jackets. We weren't that stupid. We didn't want them to drown, but we weren't bothered about them staying warm. And one particular guy, the guy that mentioned it to me on Friday night, he got in the water, and I said, right, this is how you get up. This is how to hold your body, bob around, shout, go when you're ready to go. But golden rule, if you fall forward, just let go of the rope. We'll come back and pick you up, okay? Fine. So there he is, bobbing around in the water. Shout, go. And my dad was driving the boat. And he pulls him up out of the water. And he goes head first straight into the water. and doesn't let go of the rope. So he's hanging on to this rope, and I can still see it today. The water's pressing against his face as he's firing through the water and couldn't hang on any longer. The rope flung out of his hand. We went back to pick him up again, and I went back to the back of the boat and said, "Come on, right, get out, let's have another go." He said, "I'm not getting out." I said, "Come on, get out, we'll have another go." "I'm not having another go," he said. I said, "Listen, we all crash first time. Get out, have another go. Try again, Brian." He said, "I'm not getting out, JP." I said, "Why?" "I've lost my tracksuit bottoms and my underpants." So there he was, half naked in Lake Windermere. And this is me replacing bad memories with happy memories. I'm very happy about it. So I got this towel. I was like, rather, I thought it was quite funny. Got this towel to get him out. And this is truth. He would tell you the truth. Just as he's getting out and his little pink bottom coming out of the water, one of those steamers comes past, full of like holidaymakers with the cameras. So we had to push him back in the water. He obviously remembers it. I remember it with great joy. I don't know what he remembers, but he likes the fact that I remember. But giving people experience in life, expanding people's horizons. That the guy that he's married to, Nicola, she was 32 before she saw the sea, never left Leeds. And she shrieked the first day she felt sand under her toes on a beach. Wonderful. You know, so much we take for granted. But these are all building blocks of life that people have never had. And we're just trying to put those building blocks back in. We're trying to catch up. And it's never going to be done perfectly. But at least we can give them something that they can look back on and say, "Oh, what a wonderful day that was." And hopefully that means those awful memories will begin to fade a little bit. Now, we know that sometimes they come back, but the more we can put them in the distant past, the better, and replace them with wonderful days. You and I know there is nothing more special than the day you met Jesus. Nothing more special. So ultimately, we want people to meet him and know him, because that will obliterate any experience we can give them. It will broaden their horizons in a way that we can never broaden their horizons, the day they meet Jesus and receive a hope and a joy and a peace that only he can give. Of course, issues of ongoing abuse, it's not just things from the past. Ongoing abuse causes people to live chaotic lives. And I was just sharing, we were dealing with issues today of live issues of childhood, modern day slavery issues. The awful thing with the pandemic was it caused so many awful crimes to be done under the cover of darkness. We didn't know what was going on. And now we're getting people back and we're seeing things and dealing with issues. It's because things are being unearthed again. One young lady was caught into one of those awful sex rings groomed during the pandemic. You know, those awful ones where you see that lineup of rotten men that we see in Rotherham. She's in one of them. And we were working with other agencies to try and get her out of there. We're the only people in this world she really trusts, to be honest with you. She's a care leaver, only 20 years old. And we thought we were getting out of that situation with her, and she put herself back in there again. And her comment was this to me when I said, "Why have you done that?" She said, "Well, it just numbs the pain for a while." And I'm thinking, well, how bad must the pain be for you to put yourself back in there? This is now all imploding. We just heard this morning that she once again tried to take her own life. She's now in ICU in St. James's Hospital. We don't know if we're going to keep this child on earth. We've been praying for her this morning, because we believe the Spirit can speak into her heart at any moment. She's experienced love. She knows who we believe in. We pray that she'll reach out to him in her need. But this is a chaotic, messy, broken world that only the Prince of Peace can do something about. And that's why it's important we do what we do in the community of people that he's laid on our hearts to share his love with and his gospel with. You know, we believe, don't we, that Christ is the life transformer. We believe that. And what Paul said in Romans 1, he said, "For I'm not ashamed of the gospel," and we're not ashamed of the gospel. We work in a very liberal part of the world, actually, care world is. And we live in place, proclaiming the gospel, standing upon the gospel of Christ. But Paul says, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it's the power of God for salvation for everyone who believes." It's the power of God, the life-transforming power that turns night into day, that brings peace where there is no peace, joy where there is no joy, forgiveness where there is just shame. This is the power of Jesus. But who is it for? Everyone. It's for salvation for everyone who believes. Not just your clean living people, but for everyone. The broken and the socially sorted. It's for everyone. We believe the love of Jesus is powerful. You know, just really to close this bit, because I'll go on too long. There's so much I could say. We should never take for granted, as God's people in his church, just how powerful Christian love is. We do. We take for granted what we are part of. This should be the safest and the happiest place on earth, the Church of Christ. And we often, too often abuse it, hurting one another. I have a gentleman who comes to Caring for Life. He's been with us quite a lot of years. He's a lovely Christian man, a gentleman. But him and his brother grew up in a home where it was his mum who did the awful things to him. And he was fostered off to Christian foster parents who loved him, were gentle and patient and kind, as parents should be. And he's now with us, a lovely Christian man, lives in our home. His brother was fostered off to cruel foster parents, and he's now serving multiple life sentences for rapes and murders. Christian love is powerful. The Christian family should be the place where people find healing and hope, because Christ is at work here. We often forget, but we really, really shouldn't. You know, we thank the Lord for the way that he is at work through this ministry, leading people to himself, drawing people to himself. And we thank the Lord for the fact that, okay, you might come and meet them, you think, well, they've got learning difficulties, they've got mental health issues, they can't read and write, but they're mighty people of God. One of my dearest friends is a guy called Joseph. And if you ever come to Leeds, you'll meet him. In fact, you'll see him at the beginning of our film. At the beginning, it talks about family. And Joseph, on the first visit of the Countess of Wessex to Caring for Life, he said to her, "This is my shire horse, ma'am, my shire horse. His name is Luther, ma'am, after Martin Luther. Have you heard of him?" She says, "Oh, yes, I have. He was a Christian, ma'am." "Is that right?" "Yes." "Are you a Christian?" And I'm thinking, that's a bit straight in the face. She's only been here 5 minutes. "Are you a Christian, ma'am?" And she goes, "I think I am." He says, "It's no good thinking, you need to know." Isn't that glorious? We've got people who we are in relationship with, who have come to us for love and care, who are now witnesses of the life-transforming power of the gospel. Praise God for that. You're going to say something now, aren't you? Yes, you can do, please. Tell the guys of some of the blessings that we're facing, would you?
Well, there's lots of battles, but always there are blessings. And so I'd like to share some of those with you, if that's okay. We've been so blessed and so encouraged to see how the Lord works in the lives of those we support, the people he brings to us and that we get to do life with day in, day out. You see, we're all about face-to-face, nitty-gritty relationships with people. We're meeting people where they're at, and we're giving them dignity, we're showing them love and the consistency of that. And it's unbelievable the impact this makes. Jonathan told you earlier about the lady who felt listened to. And one of the things she said to me recently was, "I've never felt this light and love before. The battle seems smaller with you lot around." And we seek to just walk alongside people, do life. Sometimes we can't do a lot. We're pretty useless. But it's wonderful that we can talk about the Lord, that we can pray with folks, that we can walk through whatever they may be facing. A big part of ours is doing those relationships. And we had a gentleman who we were supporting. And for his birthday, we make a big deal of birthdays. We sing a lot, usually out of tune, but we love to make a big deal of birthdays. And this gentleman had asked for his birthday, he wanted to go for a coffee and a cake with his support worker. We was like, it's pretty simple, we can do that, yeah, no bother. And as we were walking along talking about his birthday, he said, "You know, this is the first time in 40 years that someone celebrated my birthday." Something so small and yet meant so much to him. Isn't that incredible? We also are big into fun. We like making people laugh. We like making happy memories. And coming up in a few weeks is Christmas. I'm very excited. But we love having Christmas parties, having Christmas dinner, having people up at the farm. And one of the things we do every year is we have a Christmas party. Now, it is silly, it is ridiculous, and there's lots of laughter. But it's so important. And there's a lady here we support who we rescued from quite a horrible situation. She was horribly being abused within her own home. It was a domestic violence situation. And I was chatting to her recently about Christmas sketches. She's like, oh, what date is it on? Everyone's counting down to Christmas sketches already. We have to keep reminding people it's November. And I was saying when they were going to be, and she goes, do you know, that was the first time I ever laughed properly after I came out of that situation. And she remembers the Christmas sketch from that year. And so it's a bit of silliness and a bit of fun, but that's what we're all about, trying to give people happy memories and replace those. And then through all those relationships, point people to the Lord. We also have wonderful Bible studies every month, and we are making our way through Philippians at the minute, and we have people coming along there who you wouldn't expect, completely unexpected people who we just invite everyone and anyone. Everyone knows and when you engage with us, what we do and why we do and who we love, and so we just invite everyone along. And we have one gentleman who, there's so many big questions, but one gentleman, do you want to tell the story? Because I know how much you love this story.
Right, so one of our guys, we were leading a study on feeding of the 5,000, okay? And there's a lad, we've got two guys come, one's a goth, heavily into goth stuff, and the other one's a Satanist. And you think, well, that's a bit horrible, but actually it's marvellous that they're coming and sitting under the gospel, right? So they're sitting there, and this lad who's a goth, he's like listening, and he's going, I could see his face, and he's going, that's a load of rubbish, that. He fed 5,000 men, women and children, 12 baskets left over, but a rubbish. Mad, these Christian people. So at the end of the study, he says, I want to ask something. So I said, yeah. He says, that fish could have been a tuna, because they are massive, those tunas. I said, it could have been a tuna, but that little boy, what a pack up that was, carrying two fish that size up a mountain. That's why I love it. You get questions like that.
You do. You get big questions. Massive questions, questions like that. And this guy's consistently come to our Bible studies, and just, we have Bible study there on Tuesday, and it was unbelievable, wasn't it? He came along, and he came in, and there was just something completely different about him. And he sat down, and he got the Bible, and he said, Aaron, will you help me find the book we're going to be looking in? Will you help me? Remind me what those numbers mean? And so we're teaching people what chapters and verses and books of the Bible means. And at the end of it, he came running up to you at the end, didn't he? And asked if he'd come along to church. So please do be praying for him that he will come along to church. And more than that, that he'll come to know the Lord. But yeah, we're seeing people saved. We're seeing people's lives being completely transformed. And during the pandemic, in the midst of all the yuckiness and the battles, we had 8 people come to know the Lord as their Savior. And there's one lady who, she came along to Bible study, and she sat there and her eyes were like big, wide eyes. And she was staring the whole time. And when the drive on the way home, she said, why did no one ever tell me about Jesus before? And that's a privilege that we have in the work that we do, to point people to Jesus, to tell people about Jesus. And a few weeks after that, she came, we were driving up to Bible study yet again. And during the drive, she said, you never guess what, Erin? I've got a new friend, and his name is Jesus. Isn't that incredible? Another story, I will tell you this one, I will stop telling stories, but it was a gentleman who, one of the first conversations I ever had with him, he said, don't be telling me any of that Jesus stuff. I'm happy to have your help, but I don't want to know any of the Jesus stuff. And we had conversations, and his story is he fell off a roof whenever he was in his 20s, and it caused damage all the way down his spine. So he lives in this constant state of pain. He's had series of operations, but none have been successful. And some of the conversations we were having on the phone during the pandemic were quite heavy. He was in a lot of pain. And as I said earlier, we don't know all the answers. We're pretty rubbish. And I said that to him. I was like, I don't know the answer, but I'd love to pray with you if that's okay. And so he gave us the opportunity to pray with him. A few weeks after that, he asked for a Bible, and we dropped one off. And then one day, I get a missed phone call with a voicemail. And I listened to the voicemail. It's like, it's urgent, Aaron. You need to phone me back. So urgently phone him back. And he goes, Aaron, you'll never guess what. I was making a cup of tea and I dropped my Bible. I don't know where I was. Jesus was doing a miracle. And I says, okay, we're going to have to narrow that down a little bit, okay? And then the following week, he phoned and goes, you never guess what. On Saturday night, I burnt my chicken curry. I was so engrossed in what I was reading in the Bible. And that guy came to faith and he loves the Lord. And his best friend is a guy who we've supported for many years, who is such an evangelist for the Lord. He loves to tell everyone and anyone about Jesus. We also produce Bible reading notes. So Esther, our co-founder, has been producing Bible notes in her retirement, which are accessible and easy reading. So the paper that's used is helpful for people with dyslexia. The font is bigger so that people can take it in. And it's just really simply explained. And the minute Advent ones are being produced, and they're due to go out in the next couple of weeks. We have about 50 to 60 people who receive those notes every few weeks. So we're praying for those as people make their way through the Bible. I'll finish with one more story and then I'll leave it. But this is a lady who we started supporting during the pandemic, and she's had a horrible, horrible childhood. And like Jonathan was saying, the importance of Christian family, she was fostered into a Christian family after suffering serious abuse in her childhood. And she went along to church, but that placement fell through. And we got to know her because she was two young children and just having a real crisis situation. And struggles to leave the house, really isolated, and financially was really struggling. We got to get to know her, and we found out that one of her big passions is horses. And so she came up and she met the horses. And we often talk about being in borrowed trust from the animals, because those horses are so therapeutic. They won't tell anyone anyone's secrets. So people love them and they come and chat to them. And she loved her time with the horses. And after that, she came back down into my office, and I had some Bible reading notes left on my desk that I hadn't put away or posted off to the next person. And she goes, "You wouldn't mind if I have those Bible reading notes?" And I says, "Of course not. And we'll give you a Bible to go with it." So we went and got her a Bible, and she was walking out the door. She was like showing everyone the Bible. It was like out here in front of her going, "Look, I got a Bible. Can you believe I got a Bible?" But one of the things she said that really struck me was she said, "God isn't finished with me yet. I can tell that that's why you guys have come back into my life. That God isn't finished with me yet." And so through all these conversations, through all these interactions, we seek to point people to Jesus. And we thank the Lord for the opportunities that we get, for the people that he puts in our path and into our care to enable us to do that. And thank you for your support and enabling us to do that too. Do you want to finish
up? Yeah, we're so grateful that the Lord has blessed us. It would be a bit miserable work if we never saw any blessings, wouldn't it? But the fact we are doing it is because it's his work. Because he's very much in the midst of it all, and we've got him at the forefront of what we do. The book, the Bible study notes should be encouraging. I value your prayer for this, because I'm hoping it's going to really bless people around the country. EP, and maybe 10 of those are going to be producing our first notes on Matthew's gospel, and we're hoping it'll be the start of a series that we'll be able to produce that might be able to minister to not just those that we support, but others around the country as well. So value your prayers that that'll be a real blessing to people. But partnership is greatly important to us. And the partnership we have with you and many other Christians, it is a lifeline, and we thank you for that. So we would just ask you to please continue to pray for us. We need to be upheld every single day by God's people. We meet together as a team, and many of our guys in our care come and join us at 8:30 every morning. And that's how we start the day. And go in his strength. So if you can pray with us, then great, remember us. But if you can remember this ministry, and especially those in our care, that the Lord will really come and meet with them, and they will accept him as Saviour and Lord. Obviously, we need the support of God's people. And if you're interested in receiving our prayer bulletin, some of you already do, please sign up after, and we'll be delighted to send you a monthly update on what's going on in the work. And there's prayer points then. There you can receive. We can send one to the church as well, if you'd like to receive those. If you know of people who are interested in this type of ministry, Christian people, good, solid Christian people, send them to us. Send them to come and have a chat with us, because maybe it's right at some point for them to come and work in this kind of ministry. We're finding it hard to get good Christian people to come and work in ministry. We're finding it hard in the church, never mind in ministries like ours. But if you get to know anybody who have the same kind of heart for these types of people as us, introduce them to us. Please do. If you want to come and visit us, then you'll be very welcome. We will give you the time to come and share with you more, introduce you to what's going on in the work. And also, if we can be a blessing to you in any way, we've learned by our mistakes more than anything else, if I have to be honest with you. But there may be things that we know and resources that we have that we could help you with here. You're going to come into contact with people who live messy and chaotic lives too, with all sorts of things, practical, spiritual. If we can help you, then we're here. Contact us. Let's work together to bring God's glory here on earth within this glorious community of people he's brought to us. I'm going to show you a little film now. This little film is called Jesus and Me. And I've been asked many occasions by those in our care, tell people how I came to know Christ. So we've told you a few. But everybody you'll see on this film are people who have come to know and love Jesus through their time with us at Caring for Life. And now in the church, in different churches, gospel churches. You'll have to listen hard through the stuttering and the stammering, as we say. The song was written by a lovely Christian man in Scotland called Steph McLeod, a lovely gospel writer. And the song is very much his testimony. It's called When I Found Jesus. But his testimony is very much the testimony of those people in our care. So I hope you're encouraged by listening to these guys as opposed to me.
In 1987, Caring for Life set out with two very distinct purposes. The first was an action to practically meet the needs of adults who had experienced homelessness, abuse, neglect, or may have been completely isolated or were struggling to survive. The second reason Caring for Life came into existence was to simply introduce people to a peace and a love that can only be truly experienced by knowing and loving Jesus, and to help people find him as their personal friend and saviour. This short film is just a glimpse into the heart of a few amazing people we have had the privilege of being able to help on that journey. And we pray you will be encouraged as you hear how our Heavenly Father has enabled them to be transformed into one of his children, and how they now have a peace and a hope that only Jesus can give.
Being a Christian made me feel happy. Made me feel I was part of a family. And then now I do feel like I'm part of a family now.
Jesus, he was holding on to me. I was broken and couldn't stand on my own two feet.
I've enjoyed the Bible studies and I want to know a bit more about Jesus Christ. He was born to, he died for us so we get a better life, going to a better world where there ain't no pain. And
I found Jesus, he was standing over me. I was down and out and living on the street. There were times I could have died, but the Lord was by my side. I didn't know it then, but I can say it by the blood of Jesus.
Last night after Bible study, I suddenly felt like God had gone, it was all not real. But I asked God to show me he's there. God showed me that he's here and he heard and hears every one of my dear God prayers. I love God and now I know he's listening and taking care of us. I'm going to keep praying. God loves us no matter what.
He gave me peace from my
truth. I think we'll have to have a change, but it's not like an outward change, right? If we'll talk to someone about what I am, it's sort of inside.
I found Jesus, he was walking next to me. On the lonely path of my man-made destiny. He must have looked into my eyes, saw the tears and heard my cries. For where I stood, I was saved by...
I think it's useful to announce a certain way from purpose in life. Knowing that there's a God out there who uses his son, and that whatever I've done in my past, he'll forgive me, hopefully, for anything I've done wrong in my life, or if I've been showing malice to anybody else for forgiveness, and he'll forgive me for that, but I try not to. I'm just trying to be the best person I can be. And I know that he is there for me, and he helps me do that.
He calls.
be easy. For one touch from the King of Kings changed everything. I just want to be growing to know God more and go to Bible studies and listen to Him more and just to love Him as He opened me.
Yeah. You know, as I've grown up as well, I was kind of like saddened by what went on with Jesus. But Caring for Life has taught me it was done for a reason, and it was His reason. It was God's reason, and that's what makes it. It was telling us not to feel guilty, but embrace. And is you're embracing death, is you embracing a new life as well.
We thank the Lord for all these precious souls, souls who are now His children. We hope that you can see beyond the stuttering and the stammering and hear their hearts speak about their love for Jesus.
Do you have time for questions, David? Have
we perhaps have one or two, but also, maybe if we have, I've asked one or two people to pray, and maybe, I know you're going to be probably hanging around here, and then people can ask questions individually. So I've asked Courtney and Steve, they can pray, and then I'll close in prayer. And then if somebody can think of a hymn to sing, then share it out. Thank you, Courtney.
Gracious God and Heavenly Father, we do give Thee thanks for that burden that You laid upon the heart of our dear brother Peter Parkinson so long ago. We thank Thee that he is now with Christ his Saviour, and we thank Thee, Lord, that he was obedient to the call and how the work began, and we can truly say tonight, to God be the glory, great things He has done. And we look to the future, and we ask, O God, that our continued smile upon this work for the glory of Thy name. We pray that every need will be supplied. We pray that the Lord's people in the land will look upon this as a ministry which they can truthfully and honourably support. And we ask, O God, that in our Father's name, even here this evening, many more may come to hear the good news of the gospel and repent of their sins and find Christ to be their Saviour. We pray for all the workers at Caring for Life, that Thou give them added grace and strength, we pray, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank You that we've had a privileged evening this evening. We thank You that we've been able to learn more and more of Your love, shown in amazing ways, perhaps such simple ways sometimes. Lord, we thank You that You can use anyone in Your service. And we thank You for using Caring for Life over this last 35 years. Father, You've been very gracious to them. You've provided them with all they've needed. You've helped them through very difficult times. And Lord, You've given them some wonderful times of blessing as well. And Lord, as that charity continues, we just pray that You'll bless it even more than You have in the past. We thank You, Lord, that You know the reason it started and the reason it's continuing. And You know the main reason is, Lord, to bring people to know that they need You as Lord and Saviour. Lord, there are many physical, practical, emotional problems in their lives of the beneficiaries, but we thank You that You know all about them. And we thank You, Lord, that You brought Jonathan and Aaron to us this evening so that they've been able to share some of the burdens they have for these people. And although, Lord, we may not remember the names of many, we thank you that you know all those individuals they've spoken about this evening. And we would just lovingly bring them to you and ask that you will bring peace into their lives. We pray that you will guide Jonathan and the whole team of Caring for Life, the staff and the volunteers, Lord, as they serve you day by day at Craighouse Farm, through all the projects on the farm, and for being their team as they go out across Leeds and meet people in their homes. We pray, Lord, that you will strengthen them, that you will encourage them, that you'll keep them safe as they go into situations which can be very unpleasant. And we just ask, Lord, that you'll protect them. We thank you for the wonderful encouragements that they have had recently, and we pray that in the coming days they may see even yet more. Father, we remember with great affection dear Joe that we saw on the film just now when he came down here a few years ago. Father, what a tremendous blessing you have been through him to others. And we would just bring him, Lord, to you at this time and ask, Lord, that you will draw very near to him personally, as we would ask you to do this for all the beneficiaries at Caring for Life. Father, we just pray that if you want us to do anything for you through the work of Caring for Life, you will show us. We know, Lord, it's not always easy. We have problems of our own, but we just ask that if you want us to do anything, Lord, you will open our eyes to see. You will open our ears to hear what you want us to do. You will open our hearts to be open to what you want us to do. And you will open our lives to respond. Thank you, Lord, for this time. We just again would pray that you'll continue to bless Caring for Life, and that as you've helped them so much in the past, you will continue to help them, bless them, and encourage them as they tend to show your love to those who are broken and hurting. Father, we just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Gracious God and loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for this evening and we thank you for all that we've heard. Lord, we're conscious that we live in a broken world. We're conscious that an enemy has done this. We're conscious of Satan and the horror of sin and, Lord, and its effects on the world and on people. People made in your image. People made to reflect you and represent you and relate to you. And so, Lord, we give you thanks and we give you praise for this work, seeking to lift people's heads from the ground and to look up and to see that there is a God who has made them, and not just made them, a God who has sent his Son into the world to save people like them. So, Lord, we pray that you would bless this work, and, Lord, that you'd give all the members of staff and those involved and volunteers all the energy and strength that they need day by day. Lord, would you pour out your Spirit upon them and bless them richly. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Has anyone got a hymn that they would like to sing? This is very un-Presbyterian to do this, but we're not typical Presbyterians. To God be the glory. Yeah, we can do that. Number 44. Oh, is it? No, it isn't. That's Glory Be to God the Father. It's 100 and something. Maybe not. One thirty-seven. Thanks, Jesse. Biscuit, and also to look at all the various things that are over there. I very much encourage you to do that. Let's receive the grace. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.
Amen. Amen.